Welcome, everyone. Again, my name is Tammy Dillard Stills, and I'm the Executive Director of YALSA. And you are attending The Importance of Seeing Me in Within the Doors of the Library, our Teen Summit special snack and chat. This will run until 2:30. And I would like to begin by introducing the panelists as I say your name and give a little background about you. Just kind of wave your hand so everyone knows who you are in this virtual world. So we'll start with Dante Evans. Dante is a junior at Purcell Marion High School in Cincinnati, Ohio. In his free time, Dante enjoys reading and chilling with his friends. Dante plans to attend college after graduation. Anthony Davis. Anthony Davis is an early graduate senior at Andrews High Point in High Point, North Carolina, with type 1 diabetes who has overcame many obstacles. Anthony plans to major in graphic design at the University of North Carolina, Charlotte in the spring. He enjoys reading comic books and MAGA, as well as watching anime and film. Next, we have October Price. October Price is a high school sophomore from Mableton, Georgia. October is part of the LGBTQIA+ community, non-binary and pansexual and Black. Z is short for your nickname. Z reads a lot of fantasy, YA mythological and mythological from around the world. October's pronouns are Z and Zer. We also have Jeremiah West. Jeremiah West is a 16-year-old from the south side of Chicago. Whoop, whoop, Chicago. He loves sports, reading, and video games. Most of Jeremiah's time growing up was spent outside or holed up in the library, seeing what he could get his hands on. Jeremiah is very passionate about the things and people he loves and considers himself outspoken and strong-willed. Jeremiah recently moved to the American South and tries his best to stay true to himself at all times. And our final panelist is Zion Young. Zion Young is a sophomore at Southwest Guilford High School in North Point, North Carolina. In her free time, you will catch her reading a book or in the dance studio. Zion enjoys talking to new people because everyone can give you a different perspective on different topics. When Zion gets out of school, she plans to major in biology to help in pursuing a career in anesthesia. And our moderator today is Kiara Vargas. Kiara is an educator, lawyer, and librarian whose education consulting firm, Epiphany LLC, focuses on mentoring students and educators by assisting them with growth on topics that are typically taboo in society. Her experience in classrooms and libraries and within many organizations she consults had afforded her an abundance of experience that has helped her over the years. Kiara obtained her BS in journalism and mass communication and a master's degree in science and English education from North Carolina Agricultural and Technical State University. She received her teaching credentials from Greensboro College and has teaching licenses in several states over the years. She's obtained a master's degree in library information sciences and a Juris Doctor. Kiara will begin her PhD studies in the School of Information Sciences at the University of South Carolina in fall 2021. Additionally, she is on various committees for the American Library Association. Kiara, can you take it from here?
I sure will. Thank you so much, Tammy. Thank you. Welcome, everyone. Thank you so much again for that song, Dante. I didn't hear that. I have never heard that song before, but I like it. We'll get to butterflies eventually too, Jeremiah. So very first thing, all of you all like to read. So I have to ask this question first. What book are you reading right now? I'll share my book, you share your book. Who wants to go first?
The book I'm reading right now is actually Bram Stoker's Dracula.
Oh, I remember the TV show a long time ago.
That's where I heard about it from, and that's how it was a book. I just picked it up.
I never knew it was a book. You haven't sent me that information. I remember that. Who's going next? Thank you, Jeremiah. October, what are you reading?
I'm reading Black Marxist by Cedric Robinson, just because.
Wow, very impressive. How do you like it?
It's pretty good. It's informative. I'm trying to comprehend words, but.
Yeah. So do you have like index cards with a whole bunch of definitions? How do you annotate your text? Do you annotate your text?
No, I do not. I just read for fun.
Okay. What about you, Dante? You reading anything?
Right now I'm reading this manga called Tokyo Revengers.
Oh, okay.
And I just caught up on latest chapter.
You just finished what?
I just caught up on the latest chapter.
Okay, you have to tell me about that. I have a couple of pieces of manga on my list. Have you read One Piece? I just learned about One Piece a couple of days ago.
Oh, it's slow for that.
Say it again.
It's slow. There's over 1,000 chapters.
I heard. Like, I'm so overwhelmed.
It's about to hit 1,000 episodes.
Have you watched them?
Some of them.
I'm wondering what are y'all using your time for? Because I heard a lot of you teens have watched almost 1,000 episodes of this.
I'm on episode 453.
Oh my gosh, 453, wow. Okay, Mr. Davis, what about you? What are you reading?
I'm reading the Hillbilly Elegy right now by J.D. Vance.
Okay, how do you?
Sorry, it's a book.
Okay, you know it's a movie. There's a movie on Netflix.
Yeah. Right?
Mm-hmm. Yep. And Zion, what about you? Are you reading anything?
I'm rereading the whole Harry Potter series for my sister so I can connect with her better because I don't understand most of the stuff that she says.
Because she likes Harry Potter?
Yes.
You know, I tried to get into Harry Potter some years ago and I just couldn't.
Dang, it's hard.
It is. It takes a special person. There's special people to appreciate Harry Potter, and I'm just not that special person. I'm going to get there one day. I'm going to. So tell me this. Each one of you all have visited a library before, right? Of course. That's why you're here. And I want your thoughts on what does a welcoming library look like to you? And we'll start off with Mr. West. And then we'll get Mr. Davis to chime in and I'll just kind of see who wants to go next. But what does a welcoming library look like to you?
To me, a welcoming library is, it's just a free space where you can work on whatever, gives you a quiet space to work whatever you need to work on. You can pick out a book if you'd like. There's nothing stopping you from going in there and picking up a book, getting a library card. It's all just free, open to anyone, things like that.
Okay. What about you, Mr. Davis?
I was going to say, it feels like somewhere, like a safe place to just like read to your heart's content, do whatever you need. Essentially feel productive.
Okay. Who wants to go next? Cyan?
I would say just walking in, feeling a calm atmosphere. Bright colors.
Okay. October?
Yes, I like the library atmosphere and its book smell. I don't.
No, seriously, I do too. Like, that's why I became a librarian, I swear. Like, I just love the touch of a book, the smell of a book, just being able to turn pages. Like, I just love books. So that's what a welcoming library looks like. You can smell the books.
Yes.
Okay. Dante?
So a welcoming library to me is like a place where like you could just walk in, just like talk to people or like just honestly just hang out and chill.
Okay. Now I have an example, or rather I have a story about both good and bad about librarians. Let's start off with good. Do you have an example or a story about a librarian that was just went over the top to assist you? And what did he or she look like?
I'll be honest, the best librarian I've ever had was at my last high school. And the best thing they ever did for me was they just left me alone. And okay. I just walked in there, grabbed a book I liked, and I walked out, and I just kept on reading. And I just kept doing that till I left the school. So there was never really anything stopping me from reading a book. Because the librarian, I feel like they're an important part of the library, but for high schools, you don't really need that. You know what you want when you go in there, pretty much.
But do you see, and it's a follow-up question for you, and I'm going to get to the same question for everyone else, but do you also see the librarian as more than helping you check out books? Have you ever used the librarian for anything additional, like research in school, or to recommend a book for you, or maybe programs that they've hosted?
I don't think I've ever been to a program where the librarian's hosted, but I have asked them for recommendations on a good book, or if I'm researching something, I'd ask them what their opinions are, like which sections are. Things like that.
Okay. Who wants to chime into that question? A good experience that you've had with a librarian. I see you're thinking. That's a good thing. Anyone?
So a year or two ago before COVID and stuff, I would go to this one librarian and just ask for some advice about life and stuff.
Okay. And she or he was able to give it to you?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, most definitely.
Very good. Very good. Anyone else? Library experience? Go ahead, October.
Apparently, I learned that I was a library helper in middle school. I do not remember the experience as much. But I do know that, when I got my first library card, my librarian is really nice. And if I remember correctly, she was Black, I think. I might not remember correctly, but I think she was Black and she was really nice. So.
Okay. So what type of books do you feel that you need in a library? Let me help you understand this question. So I grew up in Newport News, Virginia many years ago. I'm old enough to be your parent. And I remember going into the library, and I share this with people all the time. There were not a lot of books that I could relate to outside of the Babysitter Club books, V.C. Andrew books. And there were a couple more book series that I could really get into. But for me, there were not many books that I was able to relate to. What type of books do you feel you need or resources do you need in a library? Let's start with Zion. What type of resources or books do you feel that you need to make you feel welcomed?
I enjoy reading manga, and I have realized at my public library, they don't have a big manga section. Mm. Resource-wise, there was a time when I didn't have Wi-Fi, so I was going to a public library to use their Wi-Fi. And they didn't have a lot of computers. And the computers that they did have, it was broken or they weren't fixing it like that. Also, low-cost printing. I have realized that since the pandemic, everybody's been going up on the price for printing.
What? Say it again, Zion?
Printing.
Okay. Oh, printing. Okay.
Yes, because I sometimes have to go to the public library to print stuff, and the cost usually is very high when it used to be low. So low-cost printing would be nice to help me as well.
Okay. What about you, October?
So in my middle school, because that's when I really used to go to the library all the time, they had a very small section of like LGBTQ books and then like also people of color. Like it was really small and it was all in the same section. And I think a little bit more of that because they were fun and they were good, but there could have been more. And then in the books on people of color, a lot of them weren't really like, my genre is fantasy. I like sci-fi and fantasy. So there weren't a lot of that. It was a lot of sadness. but yeah, and then resource-wise, I really like, I go there to look up stuff because I like reading about psychology and culture studies, and there were like a few of those books. And they were big textbooks, and I like that, so those are good.
Okay. What about you, Jeremiah? And I love your shirt. I am Black History.
I feel that the library could use, well, you could use a lot more things such as Black leads area, like category. That I see that on Netflix or for movies, and I actually really enjoy that. I just browse that section a lot. It helps me see what I'm looking for in movies. But also, we need more information, I feel, like, or make it easier to see, because I haven't seen anything like this personally, about our history, because the schools aren't teaching us anything. So libraries should be that medium that helps bridge the gaps there.
I completely agree. I do. Go ahead, Anthony.
Piggybacking off what Jeremiah said with the information, I was thinking about this. I remember in like elementary school, middle school, we would have things where we'd go to the library to watch movies and TV and stuff like that, just videos. And I think that if we had something like that informational wise, I think that would be cool. Even if it's something small or like you said, like a Black lead, I feel like it would help a lot of students, and a lot of kids.
You have anything to share, Dante?
Not really.
Okay. So you all know the title of this panel is The Importance of Seeing Me Within the Doors of the Library. And all of you all are minorities up here. You know, we ask you all to join us so that librarians can kind of get an idea of what they need to do in order to overcome obstacles, particularly with assuring all students, all patrons, Black, white, Asian, all ethnicities feel comfortable. So this panel is primarily for, it really is for minorities. As a previous librarian, one of the things that I know is that the libraries, they're filled with about 80% of white women and men. And this right here, it does disservice many of our minority students. So my very next question for you all is, what does implicit bias look like to you? What does implicit bias look like to you? And have you ever witnessed it? It may not have necessarily been with you, but have you ever witnessed it in a library? And maybe not in a library, but maybe even in a schoolhouse, because you all are in a schoolhouse and the library is connected to the school for many of you all. So have you ever witnessed that?
I don't think I have a story from a library per se, because I've been going to a library since I was about 6 or 7. My mom made sure I had a card. And I don't think anything's wrong with going there, but school-wise, yeah, for sure. Because I've been passed up on many opportunities for leadership roles at my school that I've tried for, and I'm fairly certain it's because of my skin.
Okay. Anyone else? Anyone else? So let's go back. What does implicit bias look like? What is implicit bias? You want to share, Zion? What is implicit bias? What is implicit bias? What does it mean to you?
Can I give an example?
Absolutely.
Okay. I would say, take somebody homeless. People tend to automatically think they are a criminal or they need the money for drugs, just automatically off the bat. You see somebody homeless asking for money.
And you know, it's interesting with a lot of public libraries, you find a lot of homeless people that actually enter these libraries. And one of the things that I've noticed, you know, are the looks that librarians give to such people. So that's a really good example, a very good example. Anyone else? October, what does implicit bias look like for you?
Well, I guess it would be just that when people see you, they already have, like, I wouldn't say it out for you, but they already have an idea of who you are. And then also, like, I don't really notice a lot about the things around me, but I do think that people are surprised when they hear I do read a lot. Mm-hmm. Or things like that. But then also I look like a nerd all the time, so it's kind of confusing.
That probably is because listening to the type of books that you all are reading, your favorite books, and I'm sure if I ask you your favorite artist, which I'm about to do in a moment too, but a lot of times people probably would like automatically kind of, wow, you like manga, or wow, you like sci-fi, you know, because that is, you know, one of those, I consider them microaggressions, but that many African-Americans or Black people face. But what does implicit bias look like for you, Anthony?
So it's essentially just biased on your race or whatever. And I think that it's a preconceived notion, like she said, and people, it's hard to put it in words. People judge you off of that, and they give a decision sometimes based off of that bias they already have.
Okay. So I shared this story, and I want you to open up and share. Maybe you all have either seen something like this, or maybe it's happened to you. I was a director of a library a little less than a year ago, and I remember I had to do an impromptu implicit bias training because I had a Black male that came in and he frightened one of my library employees. And when I asked, like, what did he do? How did he frighten you? So have you all ever experienced anything like this as a teenager? He just frightened her. There was no particular reason why he frightened her. He just frightened her. Have you ever seen this? I have two Black males on the panel. Well, you know, two Black males. But, you know, have you ever seen this before? Want to share your experience? Go ahead, October.
Do you mean with, like, an adult or with, like, people in general?
It could be with people in general, but a lot of times we see adults, you know, now, you know, we see a lot more of it now too, but have you ever seen that?
Yes. I think, well, usually because a lot of my friends, they're into different subcultures, stuff like that. But even so, I do have a lot of Black friends, and for, like, adults are, you know, they don't look at them correctly. But then also for myself, like, people will assume, like, I had a story of where I went to a camp and it was a majority white camp and they all thought my name was Sharkeisha? Something that was clearly not my name at all. But that's what they thought when they first saw me. So, yeah.
They made a horrible assumption. Mm-hmm. Anyone else want to share, Jeremiah?
I mean, I've gotten kind of in trouble. They just told me that I can't be here for that long, where I was just in the library for about 3 hours, I think, just reading a book, because my mom had dropped me off there for a bit, you know, and then eventually one of the people that worked there told me that I can't sit in this area for that long, and I had to leave, so.
What about you, Anthony?
I can't think of an experience off top of my head right now. I feel like there probably is some more, but yeah, I just know that, like, being a 6'2 black male, you know, just walking in the library, people tend to tense up just because they're like, oh yeah, like, what is he doing? You know what I mean? And it's just assuming, so.
Okay. So, okay, here we go. It's a hard question for some of you all. So last year, we know what happened with a lot of Black Lives Matter incidents. So how do you feel that the library should respond to, or do you think the library should respond to such matters? How can the library make sure they are being fair and being equitable by showcasing things that are your daily lives?
Yeah, I can go. So I know how, like, they usually have, like, bulletin boards and stuff at the library. Depending on what season it is, they'll have decorations and decor for the specific holidays, like Christmas and St. Patrick's Day, etc. I think that they should maybe do something specific to races, to any group of people, just so that way you can have more information, like we said, be more informative with people, and just help people learn. I think that helping people learn through the library and through things that they like is much easier than just shoving it down their throat. And I think that, yeah, that'll help.
What do you think, Zion?
Going back on what Anthony said, exactly what he said, that's basically what I think as well would be a good idea for it.
Jeremiah?
I look at the library and I think we use that to be informed. So the library, like Anthony said, should be there to inform us, because if we're just shoving information down people's throats, they're not going to listen. They're just going to get defensive and try to start an argument. So just having that information there readily available at any time is better than just trying to throw programs that might not work, might have the opposite effect.
That's good. That's a good response. What about you, October?
Yeah, Anthony is correct all the way. I just learned myself a few months ago that there were so many different history months for, like, all types of races. And it's not really shown a lot. And so having that along with, like, a Black Lives Matter thing would be great. And then also, if there was, like we said in the previous question, if there was shows where they had Black leading, Asian leading, Hispanic leading, like, if they had shows like that, that would be so much informative and then good for just to diversifying people's books.
So what advice do you have for librarians? Because again, librarians, so can you all think of a time that you may not have been comfortable doing something, right? So I can think of many times that I was uncomfortable doing things. So again, you think about the makeup of librarians. There are a huge percent of white librarians, male and females. So they're learning about implicit bias. They're learning about microaggressions. They're learning about the prejudice that, you know, we as minorities, we face. So what advice would you give to them as young teens to get them to try to help you all see yourselves in a positive light?
I can go.
Go ahead.
I would say just to listen, and you'll have hopefully you'll have people of different minorities in your library. And so if you could just like, I wouldn't say go up to them and ask like, what would you need to change? But just to be saying and listen to them if they have anything, and you know, maybe put up a box like, hey, if you have any ways you can help this library so we can be welcoming to everybody, that would be good.
Okay.
I was gonna say something similar. Also, I was gonna say that don't be fake. Like even if you're learning how to get trained or whatever, you're training to learn how to handle different situations. Just don't make it seem fake. Like, I think you should just be there. And like how Jeremiah said, he said the best experience he had was when someone was just there and they didn't bother him. They didn't do anything to mess him up. And I feel like if someone wants that help or wants that guidance, they will come to you in any facet. You know what I mean? So.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. What do you think, Jeremiah?
Yeah, I think librarians, they can make an effort to be informed. Like, they don't have to go out there and try to do, make a survey or anything like that to see what we would like. They can just know what's going on, like keep up with everything, that's so that they're not just a tone deaf librarian stuck in the old ways. They understand what's going on. They can do what they have to, if that makes any sense.
It does make a lot of sense. Like, you know, think about this. At the beginning of the session, I asked for a song, and I'm trying to play the song again, but I forgot the, what's the title of the song, Dante?
Nights.
Nights. I really like this song too, but I play Nights. And one of the things that I always do, whether it's been when I was a teacher or a librarian, I always make sure I'm learning from you. Because as students, you all are our future. You know, Whitney Houston says that children are our future, but in reality, you really are. And in order for me to be a better educator, whether it's in the capacity of a librarian, whether it's in the capacity of a lawyer, whether it's the capacity in a teacher, I have to get to know you so that I can know how to build a relationship with you to make sure I'm helping you as a librarian. So I totally understand what each one of you all have said so far. And with that being said, I want to open up the floor for a couple of minutes from the librarians that we have, because we have about 40 some attendees, and I want to see if they have any questions. And I think I do see some, and we'll stop for a moment and then we'll come back to it. And while I'm looking at the questions, I'm gonna play Nights. I like this song, Dante. You just turned me on to something. Okay, so we do have a question for you all, and I'm not exactly who, I'm sure who this is targeted to, but an anonymous person shared, males and females don't fully encompass all of the librarians you're going to meet. Have you ever noticed if having a gender non-conforming librarian make you or your transgender non-conforming friends feel more or less comfortable in a library space? Go ahead, October.
Me and a majority of my friends are all gender non-conforming or trans or something. And nothing excites us more than learning about another adult who is also transgender or gender non-conforming. So yeah, that is definitely comfortable. So
okay. And I guess that question could actually go a different way too. Have you ever noticed if having a librarian of color makes you or your minority friends feel more or less comfortable in a library? Can anyone speak on that?
I would say more.
Okay. Okay.
Because it's stuff that like we can like, no, like not something we should have in common, but like, we could talk about different stuff. We could like talk about different stuff other than like than we would like if a person, like a non-person of color librarian. Like, I'm not sure if I'm explaining right, but like, yeah.
No, it definitely does. I understand what you're saying. And someone has a question. I have a teen library council in my library. Given teens a chance to have input in a library, does your library have anything similar? And would you want to be a part of that if you could? You're nodding your head, October. You want to share?
My library doesn't have that. Not that I know of. My library is far from my classroom and stuff like that, so I can't really go all the time. But I don't think we have that. But that would be really interesting and kind of fun if we did have that or something like that.
Okay. What about you, Zion?
I haven't been to my library, but if they did or do have it, I would.
You would, okay. Someone has a question in the chat box, and I think this is for Anthony. It says, about being fake, could you explain more? For example, how would a white woman interact with you in this way, and how could it be better?
It doesn't even have to just be white. I think it could be anything. Just don't try and be something you're not. Like, I feel like if you're genuinely there to help and guide, just be there. Just tell them that you're there. You don't have to be like, oh yeah, you need help with this, that. No, just be there and say, look, I'm here. If you need any help, if you have any issues or problems with me or with the library, let me know, and then you can cut it out. And
so to make sure you understand, what exactly does being fake mean?
That's hard to explain. Just so if you are going through training, just don't. Trying to explain.
Is it being genuine? Not being genuine.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's not being genuine. I don't know. Yeah.
Okay. Jeremiah, did you want to speak on this? Because I know you kind of elaborated when Anthony first spoke on this too.
I can give a quick little example if that'll help. Let's say nationwide or statewide, whatever level you're thinking of, someone in charge of libraries said that all librarians will go through sensitivity training, right, to better understand people. Mm-hmm. And they use that training in overabundance. Like, they'll try to connect with you too heavy or do something like that. It just makes you feel uncomfortable. Like, that's not really who you are. Why are you trying to be something you're not?
Okay. That's exactly what I meant. Yeah, thank you.
I appreciate that. I've seen that in even presentations that I've given. You know, you're right in a sense of oftentimes people who are unfamiliar with certain things, they do try too hard. And another thing that I've noticed too is not even just trying so hard, but many of them, and I don't remember who said this at the very beginning, but many people just don't actively listen. And so if you don't actively listen, then you're not going to be able to be a better librarian, a better teacher, a better, you know, professional. You can't do that. Do you have anything to say on this, Zion or October? No? Okay, so someone has another question. What is a clear way librarians can signal to you that they are a safe space and will leave you alone, but are available to help you if needed?
Like I said before, I feel like you should just be able to like signal it. You don't have to like say anything crazy. I think you should just maybe write something down saying that feel free to ask questions, or as soon as they walk in, say, hi, I'm here for help if needed. And I think they'll get the memo.
Okay. What about you, October?
The same as Anthony. I don't usually like talk to librarians a lot because first of all, they're not usually around wherever I am. But if I did have something to ask about, I would just go up to them. They don't have to come around and look for me like people at a store or something like that.
You know, I've heard a story from a student, and I've actually seen it too, where sometimes librarians, they'll follow students of color or patrons of color. And they'll just, you're nodding your head, Zion, you've seen it too. They'll just follow them. And it does become uncomfortable. And it goes back to what Jeremiah said too, like, just leave me be. You know, just because I look a certain way, just because, you know, the clothes that I have on may not be something that you're familiar with, just leave me alone. Like, leave me alone and wait till I signal for you to come over. But I've seen that before. You nodded your head, you want to share? Have you ever noticed anything like that?
It's happened plenty of times. Like, I walk in a store, a fairly expensive store, people think, what is he doing here? You know, he's a young Black male, he can't afford that, things like that. The library, yeah, it happens quite frequently. Like, someone's afraid I'm gonna steal their precious books. I don't know. It's just something that doesn't need to happen. Librarians, I'm not saying they should like stay at the front desk and wait patiently with their hands folded for us to come ask them for help, but just make it known that you're there. You could like be in the back, and just as long as we know you're there, it's fine.
And something that Anthony said too, you know, welcome me. So welcoming may mean just say, hello, how are you? If you need anything, I'm here. And then kind of let you go on your way. Because I've also noticed, I don't know if any of you all have noticed this, that sometimes I've even seen librarians to get attitudes and they have to help a certain type of person. I hate using that phrase, but a certain type of patrons, they become agitated versus taking the time to truly, you know, assist a person. You can see and feel that agitation. So another question that I have for you all, first of all, do you all have anything that you want to share? Because I know it's like a question, I'm like hammering you all with questions. So is there anything that maybe you want to share or kind of respond to that I didn't give you a chance to respond to? Okay, we're going to take, because it's been 45 minutes now. I'm going to give about 2 minutes for people to ask questions, and I'm going to play Butterflies. So I love Butterflies. Thank you for that suggestion, Jeremiah. And then we'll go with the rest of the questions. You going to sing it for us too, Jeremiah? We do have a question I'm going to ask in just a minute. Yes, if you have questions, please feel free to ask your questions. Yes, Christine. She said she was rocking this album when she was in high school. And all you got to do is not answer my call when I'm trying to get through. Any comments for our panelists, attendees? Please share them in the chat box. I know I'm cutting it off at the really good part, but I have a couple more questions. So an anonymous attendee asked, well, first of all, I said, thank you all for joining us today. I think it's interesting that you mentioned a section that calls out Black leaves, because that is something many libraries have stayed away from, and we've noticed that. There have been talks about libraries that have LGBTQ plus labels for books with gay characters, and that create issues because it creates the category of other. What do you think about that? Do you think that would lead to non-Black readers avoiding those books? There are a lot of amazing books with Black leads that should be read by all. Were you all able to hear my question? I know some people said I was low. Okay.
I can barely hear you.
Can you hear me now?
Not really.
I don't know what happens. It's like when I play my music, it somehow brings me down. But there, can you hear me?
Yeah, all right, keep talking.
Okay, so the question is, there have been talks about libraries having LGBTQ plus labels for books with gay characters, and that creates issues because it creates a category of other. What do you think about that? Do you think that that would lead to non-Black readers avoiding those books? There are a lot of amazing books with Black leads that should be read by all. And the beginning of that said, I think it's interesting that you mentioned a section that calls out Black leads, because that is something that many libraries have stayed away from. Go ahead, October.
I think the whole point of having these sections are for people who are that minority to find them, because it takes me forever. Like, if I were to go to a library, it would take me forever to find a book with someone of color or someone who was part of the LGBTQ community. Like, I don't think that, because it's like with Netflix, since that's kind of where the thing is coming from. I mean, it's for people of that community to find, because that's, I wouldn't say it's kind of what it's marketing for, but it is like who mostly consumes it. And so I wouldn't say that it would make an other, but it would push out these books so that not only can people read it, but that the authors can be represented. And it'll show that there are people who write these books and there are readers who want to read it.
And, you know, I find this really interesting, and you probably don't know this, but, you know, as librarians, you know, we are considered the gatekeepers of learning. You know, we're supposed to know all, be all, you know, and so it's interesting to always see that when you walk into so many libraries, and I'm not saying all, but so many of them, there is not a fair representation of all. You know, and I still become frustrated seeing the small little section of others, because it should be a lot bigger, but it kind of goes back to, you know, the comfort level that we talked about. One of the first things that I asked you, October, was, are you familiar with A Different World? And I wonder how many people up here are familiar with A Different World. And I asked that question because of her, what she has on. How many of you all are familiar with A Different World? Okay. But there's a reason, like I said to my attendees, that I see some hands raising. But there's a reason why I asked her that question, because if you watch A Different World, then the glasses that she has on, you know, even her hair, you know, everything, it just kind of gives you that different world perspective. And something like that librarians can just open up a conversation, you know, to build a relationship with their patrons when they come in. Anyone else want to respond to that question?
Yeah, I'll go.
Okay, go ahead.
I don't think that having different categories in that sense would like create the other situation. It would be good, because like she said, if you don't want to read that, then you just won't pick up the book. It's not that big of an issue. But if it's highlighting something that you would like to read, it makes it easier to find. All I see only positives to this.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So Zion, this question goes to you. Do you use your school or public library more?
Before COVID, I would use my school library more than my public library.
Okay. Okay. And another question, a follow-up question for you. You're not getting off the hook, Ms. Ian. What sort of programs would you participate in and want to see in your public libraries? You know, you're a sophomore in high school, so you're heading to college, you are a dancer, you like manga. So what type of programs would fit Zion?
Programs, I would say I like to program computers, so maybe like a computer program, maybe.
Okay, so for librarians to put on a program about computer programming, so maybe bringing in people of color that are computer scientists or something like that?
Yeah, and also I like the health field. And I've realized as I went through my health issues, I don't really see many people of color who are anesthesiologists. So I would like to see more of that as well.
You know, that's something that I think is important too, because I realize that a lot of minority students, they typically don't feel as if they can accomplish their goals because many don't see people like them represented in certain fields. So yeah, that would be a great thing for librarians to do. Like next month in May is healthcare month. So, you know, bring in doctors of color or just diverse doctors to ensure, you know, to make students feel as if they can conquer their dreams.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I like books. You know, we have books like Medical Apartheid by Harriet, what's her last name? I want to say it's Washington, but I may be wrong, or The Immortal Life of Henrietta Lacks. You know, but there's so many books that, you know, we can bring in to highlight and supplement them with maybe a panel discussion. Mm-hmm. What about you, Anthony? Any programs that you think that that would fit Anthony?
Yeah, there's plenty of programs. I think that, like you said, with manga, anime, all that stuff, I like art, so you could do something art related, just something that feels, exciting in a way. Yeah, I think it'd be cool.
Okay. What about you?
Well, I like all the stuff that they already said. I also, I want to be an anthropologist when I grow up. So stuff on that, and then just cultural stuff, because that's what I love to learn about. And then like I've tried to be in any LGBTQ community group, but like they're mostly white people. So I don't really find a connection there. So.
Okay. And that may actually tie into, there's a follow-up question for you, but we'll get back to that question in a minute. But what about you, Jeremiah? A program that would suit Jeremiah?
I don't actually know of any programs. To be honest, I really just want to work in a library. I've been looking for a job and a library seems fine to me. So I don't know about any programs.
Okay, but you want to work in a library?
Not like career-wise, but before I graduate high school, that sounds great.
So maybe intern in the library?
Yeah.
And where are you located? Look, we may have a librarian out here that could give you an internship. Networking. Where are you at again, Jeremiah?
Tennessee.
Okay. So a follow-up question is, do you participate in a summer reading program? And the question to this for, the answer for this for Jeremiah has already been answered. Would you volunteer at the library? I still remember, I don't know if you all are old enough to remember this, but for summer reading programs or school reading programs, we used to get pizza coupons. So if we read so many books, then we would get coupons to get a free personal pan pizza from Pizza Hut. Do y'all remember that? Y'all are young. Y'all are really young. But we also, for the summer reading program, we also had certain gifts that were rewarded. And I feel like it was still a pizza coupon too back in my day. But have any of you all ever participated in the summer reading program? No? Is there a particular reason why?
I already do reading programs for school. So to have another one on top of that.
It's just too much.
Much.
Okay. You have another question. What would your dream library look like? I have a picture of my dream library. What would yours look like? Go ahead, October.
I love it when libraries have like those beanbag chairs. And like the, I don't know, like, okay, I like the wood chairs with that, but then just having a spot that's just beanbag chairs and comfortable, or just mitch match and kind of have like a foresty feel. I love sitting there, and I can sit there forever. So I just love it when they have themes of like anything other than just the brand.
I remember working in a library, or rather just volunteering at a library in Germany, in a teen room. It was set up to be like that. They had beanbag chairs. It was just such a relaxing feel for teenagers. It was such a, I wanted to go back to be a teenager. Like, oh wow, I wish that I had something like this. Yes, and Jeremiah, you have a comment in a box. It says, if only you were in Illinois near St. Louis, we team up with our schools and get high school co-op students. We love to have you. Look into something like that in your area.
I just want to jump in, Jeremiah, or anyone else who is interested in an internship. If you send me an email at the end of this, I will definitely pass it out to our network of librarians and see what we could do for you.
Look at that. Look at that. So here's another question for you all. So we've talked about implicit bias. We've talked about being a minority. We've talked about the LGBTQ plus group. I don't know if I'm saying this right, so pardon me if I'm not, but do you have ideas about how libraries could work with other organizations or your school to help you and your peers? What could libraries and or librarians do to assist you? That's a pretty interesting question, huh? You're about to go to college. We have two Black males up here. We have two Black females up here. We have a young lady who represents the LGBTQIA. We have a dancer. You know, so what could a librarian do or libraries do to make sure they're making, you know, they're helping you? Think about what just happened yesterday or the day before with George Floyd. The trial ended. So how could a librarian make you feel comfortable with something like that? Go ahead, October.
I mean, I know that schools aren't, there are parameters that schools aren't allowed to do at schools. So like if they were to just, hey, if you wanted to see or research this stuff at the library over here, that would be good. And then also like if they moved meetings like that were at school to libraries that were close by, that would be interesting.
Okay. Anyone else?
I was gonna say, just be inclusive. So basically, like we said before, if there's information we could learn, just have it available or help us learn about it, guide us to learn about it.
Okay. You still thinking Jeremiah Zion? You don't know? You're muted, Jeremiah. I wasn't sure if you were talking. Okay. Okay. So is there something or anything that we can do to make our spaces and collections more appealing for you? And I know we've already talked about this, but you know, I'm asking it in a different way. Is there anything that a library can do or librarians can do to make sure that their library is more appealing, more inclusive, more equitable?
To me, I feel like when I step in a library, I feel like it's like a dream type atmosphere sometimes. And I think that if you allow that, so decoration that's similar to that, which is any type of decoration to make you step into that fantasy world, it'll help you. And I think it'll appeal to more audiences.
Okay. Go ahead, October.
I've been to a few libraries, and I still understand like the library codes, like the shelf, like the letterings. So maybe if there was like something that tells us what they mean, because I still don't understand it.
You know, that's so interesting. You all probably don't know about. Oh wow! So that's something curious. Maybe they
always forget it. Yeah.
Maybe they can do a webinar about how the library operates, because I didn't realize that your generation, many teachers don't teach that. You know, you probably don't even take tours, you know, to go to the library to understand the makeup of a library. Oh my gosh. So you all have no idea about any of the systems of the library. Oh, wow. Wow. You know, so I think that's something that as librarians, we have to remember. Oh, wow, I didn't think about that at all. What else could libraries do for you all, Zion?
Going back on what Anthony said, decorations, brighter colors, I realized that the library in High Point is kind of like dull. And I have trouble seeing black and white and colors, like dull colors. I can see bright colors better. And just when I go into my library, it doesn't feel like a dream. It just feels blah, like I'm just here to get a book and leave.
Okay. Yeah, you don't want your library to look like a prison. So decorations really do help. Like you don't want it to make it seem just like this bland, boring information hub, which it is an information hub, but it doesn't need to look like that, you know?
Okay. So a question that a guest asked what does safety look like? What does a safe atmosphere look like? Let me read it. Is it important for you or your peers to feel physically safe at the library? And what does that look like for you?
It's very important.
Mm-hmm.
I know, especially where I am, because I'm in the South and it's a very interesting history there. But it's very tough to go outside because I'm scared. So leaving the house to go to the library and then having to be followed around by a librarian isn't what I want to see. Mm. We don't need security guards in the library. There's just no reason. No one's going to take anything. You're perfectly safe. It's fine.
Okay.
And yeah, I think that's good.
Okay.
Yeah, I feel like the library is like one of those safe places, like how church is, where it's like, you know what I mean? So I think that the library, I think it should just feel normal. It shouldn't have to feel like it's a specific vibe you're going for or anything, if that makes sense.
Okay. And how has your library changed since COVID? Is there anything that would make you feel more comfortable coming back to public places? I know Zion and I talked about this briefly the other day, just about school being more comfortable coming back to school. You know, so going back into the library, what could a librarian do to make sure that you are comfortable returning?
Give incentive to come back.
Okay. Mask. You know, and that was an issue right there, October, because I've seen librarians, particularly with Black males and Black males that have masks on, maybe Black Lives Matter or something to that nature. And I've heard stories, horror stories about that, about how they have called the police on them or how they have treated them in a very disrespectful manner because of that. So with that being said, I just truly, truly appreciate all of you all for being here for this panel session. I wanna give it about 3 to 5 more minutes to see if our guests have any follow-up questions for you all. But I just wanna thank you for letting us take your time, because I know many of you all have, you've already been in school today. So to sit for another hour and a half, 2 hours on a panel discussion, we are just so thankful for you. Your voices are important. Okay, here's one question. Most public libraries have a standard of behaviors like no eating. What would you like to see in a standard of behaviors policy? Is there anything, or you just don't know?
Just be respectful. I mean, it's nothing. I don't think there's anything special or that I can think of that needs to be implemented.
Okay.
Yeah, we don't need any like new rules or anything like that. We already have the no eating, which I think is fine. So yeah, it's just like human decency that should be added there, nothing major. Mm-hmm.
And I want to add probably also, you know, librarians want students and patrons to respect them. So it has to be, that golden rule has to be reciprocated. Mm-hmm. Well, I thank you all so much. I thank you all so very much. Tammy, I'm going to give it back to you.
All righty. Well, thank you, Dante, Anthony, October, Jeremiah, Zion, and especially you, Kiara. This was a very, I hate to say this after the fact, but I wish I would have promoted this differently if I had known that you young people were giving so much insight. But thank you for your insight. Thank you for your bravery, for being as honest as I felt that you guys were today. And thank you for your time. And I appreciate for the members who are on here, it will be taped. We are figuring out where we're gonna post it so that you guys can have it and possibly share with others. So keep in touch, and thank you so much.